stunning landscape of southern Germany, with its pine forests, rivers, and picturesque buildings, will be familiar to many thousands of tourists as they motor across Europe to their many and varied holiday destinations. Among them will be a fair number of Channel Islanders, some of whom will be making their first visit to the area, while a few others could well be returning for one more look at the land they first saw during the Second World War, when, with hardly any notice, they were uprooted from their homes, deported to Germany, and interned. These deportations were instigated in the autumn of 1942, when Adolf Hitler, head of the German state, was infuriated by a British order which caused German civilians working in Persia and Iraq to be rounded up and imprisoned. By way of reprisal, he immediately ordered that all non-native Channel Islanders should be removed from the German-occupied islands and imprisoned on the continent. Thus, and without any prior warning, the inhabitants of Guernsey, Jersey and Sark were shaken to the core by the appearance in the respective island newspapers of a German order which announced that all non-native males between the ages of 16 and 70, together with their families of whatever age and sex, were to be evacuated to Germany. Within hours, the first deportation orders were being served on some of those who qualified, some being called from their beds at midnight and warned to be ready to leave the next afternoon. Despite the shock, upheaval, and distress caused by the suddenness of the order, everyone concerned conducted themselves with dignity and restraint when gathering at the assembly point at the JMT Weybridge garage prior to embarkation. Between September 1942 and February 1943, some 2,200 Channel Islanders left for civilian internment camps at Biberach, Laufen and Bad Wurzach, and where most were destined to remain until the end of the war. In September 1982, the 40th anniversary of the deportations was marked by the Channel Islands Occupation Society. In conjunction with the Jersey Ex-Internees Association, an exhibition of photographs, documents and paintings was held that recalled the 2.5 years spent behind barbed wire. Of all the items on display at the exhibition, it was the paintings which attracted the greatest attention. Enforced idleness sometimes brings its own compensations, and among the internees were several who discovered for the first time in their lives that they had a latent talent for art. Others took their talents with them, and all were able to record for posterity life in and around the Channel Islands internment camps, which were all situated in the lovely countryside of southern Germany, a fact, however, which was not generally appreciated at the time. The camp at Biberach was located just outside the town of the same name in the state of Württemberg and some 40 miles north of Lake Constance and the Swiss border. The 23 huts, which each housed 84 people, were laid out in neat rows and surrounded by high barbed wire fences. First, Biberach contained the first 500 or so deportees from Jersey, but after much sorting out and checking when photos and fingerprints were taken, the camp eventually became the temporary home for 1,011 men, women and children of all ages, of which all but 20 were Channel Islanders, with a greater number coming from Guernsey. Having come prepared, Mr. Harold Hepburn, a commercial artist, was able to record some early contemporary scenes at Biberach. As the camp at that time was under the jurisdiction of the German army, the men's barracks had to be ready each morning for inspection by the orderly officer. The single men over 16 years of age from all the Channel Islands were separated and consigned to another camp located within the ancient castle or schloss in the town of Laufen, situated in Bavaria and about 100 miles east of Biberach. Formerly the summer residence of the Archbishops of Salzburg, the building stood close to the River Salza, with excellent views of the Alps and Austria on the opposite bank. The building housed a total of 120 Americans and 459 British males, of which 417 were from the Channel Islands. The German authorities permitted the Laufen internees to have the use of an official camera inside the camp, with the proviso that all exposed film must pass the censor. Despite this, the best record of Schloss Laufen and its immediate environs have come from the brush of a very talented gentleman, Mr. Henry Barnett, who was permitted by Colonel Kochenberg, the German commandant, to obtain these striking views of the castle from outside the wire. But to 618 Jersey internees, and carved indelibly in their memories, the 18th century castle at Bad Wurzach was home for 2.5 years. Wurzach is a pleasant little town lying to the south of Biberach. By 1942, although the castle had briefly housed some Corsican prisoners of war, hostilities had hardly touched Wurzach, which was filled with ox carts, nuns, and church bells. The Jersey contingent travelled from Biberach to Wurzach on the 31st of October 1942, and soon afterwards both camps came under the control of the Ministry of the Interior, and the soldier guards were replaced by middle-aged policemen, most of whom were kindly disposed to the camp inmates. Other than the necessary fatigues to ensure that life in the camp was carried on as smoothly and as possible, nobody was obliged to work outside the camp, so that the artists were able to settle down to record life as it went on around them. Most prolific amongst them was the redoubtable Harold Hepburn, who produced this study of the room in which his wife and small daughter lived with about 30 other women and children for over 2 years. Home was the area immediately around your bed. Other artists also recorded scenes within the large number of rooms which the castle contained. A play area was established for the children in the forecourt. Using postcards as models, several of the artists recorded scenes around the village, as for example this view of the main road outside the camp with the rat house or town hall on the left. Wurzach Church caught the eye of several. Mr. Sidney Dolby produced a pen and ink sketch. While Miss Irene Grubb captured the same in crayon. Finally, Harold Hepburn produced this magnificent study in oils. several of the artists were bound to record the nearby Hitler Youth camp. No Wurzach internee will ever forget the Hitler Youth with their interminable singing and marching which went on day after day. Miss Joan Salmon, now Mrs. Joan Coles, had an eye for the many beautiful trees with which the camp was liberally surrounded. Although each camp developed its own lifestyle, there were several features which were common to all. Sport was one, as for example in Laufen, where with Guernsey and Jersey well represented, it was possible to play the annual competition for the Murati vase, something that the people left at home could not accomplish. Here, the camp leader, Mr. Ambrose Sherwell, later destined to become Sir Ambrose and bailiff of Guernsey, presents the trophy to the captain of the Jersey team. Biberach was unique in having a ladies' netball section. And there were many sports days, the best remembered being the one held at Wurzach on Whit Monday 1943, when three of the camp artists between them had to produce no fewer than 300 of these prize winner certificates. Other internees discovered unknown acting talents when induced to take part in the many theatrical productions staged in all three camps. These stage productions reached the highest standards with costumes and stage sets conjured up from practically nothing. Educational facilities at Laufen were excellent, and with the many learned men numbered among the internees there, it was possible to study practically any subject under the sun. Classes for the children at Biberach were held in the German headquarters block known as the Big House, and the school there attained good results, sadly never matched by its counterpart at Wurzach. The respective camp hospitals were also notable in the treatment of patients, thanks to the drugs supplied by the International Red Cross and the skill and dedication of the doctors and their staff. A camera smuggled into the Wurzach camp hospital was able to record Mrs. Emma Jins, the matron, as well as the young ladies who assisted her as auxiliary nurses. Also on hand was Sister Helen Stube of the German Red Cross, always popular with the children. During the 2.5 years of internment, there were 45 deaths among the Channel Islanders, with 23 in Biberach, 12 in Wurzach, and 10 in Laufen. There were also several births in the family camps, a distinction which, not surprisingly, Laufen was unable to match. Cases requiring specialist treatment were sent to outside hospitals, such as the one at a town called Leutkirk, where Harold Hepburn spent some time in 1943. Food, or the lack of it, is a subject dear to the heart of any prisoner of war. The ration scale provided by the German authorities in the early days was sufficient enough to ward off starvation, but definitely not enough to prevent constant and dire pangs of hunger. The staple diet was one of rye bread and vegetable soup of the Swede, green pea or red cabbage variety, a near lethal combination which produced drastic consequences after lights out. But once the Red Cross food parcels began to arrive on a regular basis at the end of 1942, the lot of the internees improved immeasurably. And by combining the German rations with the contents of the parcels, everyone fared far better than the friends and relatives left behind in the islands. With each internee receiving on average one parcel per week, the disposal of empty tins soon assumed alarming proportions. On August Bank Holiday 1944, the Wurzach kitchen staff, led by Bill Peacock, excelled themselves and by using up surplus tins from damaged Red Cross parcels, laid on a children's tea party of formidable proportions, which was duly recorded by a German photographer, and the results used for propaganda purposes. Representatives of the Red Cross from neutral countries visited the camps on a regular basis, and here a group of Swedish officials are seen at Wurzach with a camp senior, Captain J. Aston Hilton, standing on the right. And so time went by. There were autographs to collect. Birthdays to celebrate. As well as wedding anniversaries. And of course, Christmas. Laufen was a very appropriate place in which to celebrate Christmas, as it was near this town that the most famous of all carols, Silent Night, was composed. The inmates of Laufen were also fortunate to be allowed to send Christmas cards, especially designed by Henry Barnett, through the post. A reminder that every internee above the age of 16 was permitted to send 3 letter cards and 4 postcards to any destination in the world every month. Thus, the weeks went by, turning into months and then into years. The snows of winter melted into spring. Spring turned to summer, and then to autumn, followed once more by winter. The daily round and common tasks went on and on until suddenly it was 1945, and the atmosphere changed. The Allies were advancing deeper into Germany, and liberation was in the air. The end came in April, with the arrival of Free French forces at Wurzach and Biberach, while the gates of Laufen were opened by American armored troops. At a moving ceremony outside the castle, the Wurzach internees raised the Union flag, which had been handmade well in advance for just such a moment. At Biberach, everyone gathered on the camp parade ground to celebrate the occasion. Then followed a time when everyone could, within limits, enjoy their newfound freedom. It was a time to meet those German townspeople who had befriended the internees in various ways and to explore the countryside in the company of the liberating French troops. At long last, the great day arrived. Bags were packed, and everybody climbed onto French army lorries for the journey to Memmingham Airfield, where Royal Air Force Dakota aircraft were waiting to convey the ex-internees to England, where they all went their various ways until the time came for the final homecoming to the Channel Islands, to resume their lives after the 2.5 eventful years. That so many came home can be attributed to two facts. Firstly, the attentions of the International Red Cross with a regular supply of food parcels, and secondly, the Channel Islanders were confined in civilian internment camps rather than the notorious and dreaded concentration camps. It is interesting to reflect, however, that during their internment, many small children had grown up knowing nothing but barbed wire and communal living, and it took some time for them to adjust to normality. But as always, time softens memories and heals wounds. With this in mind, the Jersey Ex-Internees Association was eventually formed to promote better understanding among young people by arranging exchange visits so that the children of Laufen and Wurzach on the one hand and Jersey on the other can visit each other's homeland and so gain a better understanding of each other's way of life. Thus, good can come from evil, and perhaps the time spent in Germany was not entirely wasted after all, and we can only end by paying tribute to all those talented people who recorded in such colourful detail the life and surroundings of the 2,200 Channel Islanders who spent an unwanted and involuntary holiday in southern Germany during the Second World War.